وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المنتخبين المنتجبين المظلومين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد،
لا سيما بقية الله في الأرضين الحجة ابن الحسن أرواحنا له الفداء، صلوا على محمد وآله. My respected brothers and sisters, my elders, learned scholars, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Our heartfelt condolences to the Ahlul Bayt alayhim salamullah, especially to the Imam of our time and to Shahidi Karbala on the tragic demise of the first Mawlud to the house of Ali Payambar, Al Imam Al Hasan Al Mushtaba alayhi salam. Inshallah, over the course of tonight and the following two nights, we will be looking at the life of an Imam who is without doubt the most mazloom of all the a'imma of Ahlul Bayt alayhim salamullah. And the fact that his mazloomiyyah comes in a form not only from his enemies but also from his friends. He is an Imam who is the first of Sayyidi Shababi Ahlul Jannah. He is an Imam who was the Qibla and the Kaaba of Sayyidi Shuhada Abi Abdullah Al-Husayn alayhi salamullah. Yet at the same time we know more about As-Sibt Al-Thani, who is Imam Hussein, but we know very little about As-Sibt Al-Awwal, who is Imam Hassan Al-Mujtaba alayhi salam. Imam Hassan Al-Mujtaba alayhi salam, when we want to understand the circumstances which the mu'mineen are suffering today, as well as the defacing and the misrepresentation of Khatam al-Nabiyyin, when we look at the life of Imam Hassan Al-Mujtaba alayhi salam Allah, we find many of an example of how not only Rasulullah was misrepresented, but how Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam Allah is misrepresented. That is to say, in the time of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba, as well as today, there is much confusion about the life of this Imam. Whether we are looking in the academic world, because obviously the history of the Shia of Ahlul Bayt is not something pertaining only to the Shias, it is something which is studied and researched quite thoroughly in the Western academic world when it comes to Islamic history. But in the Western academic world, as well as the majority of the Muslimin, meaning the brothers and sisters from Ahlul Sunnah, as well as some of the Shia of Ahlul Bayt alayhim salamullah, we have all misunderstood this Imam in many ways. Allow me to explain with the salawat ala Muhammad. Amongst the Shia, we have people who still come forward and say, why did Imam Hassan alayhi salamullah enter a peace treaty with Muawiyah lanatullah alayhi? Why did the Imam not fight? Why did the Imam not do this? Why did the Imam not do that? And these questions are born from lack of knowledge about the affairs of the Imam, as well as lack of studying of the Imam from our end, as people who claim to be Shia of the Ahlul Bayt alayhim salamullah. With regards to the people of the Ahlul Sunnah, they put forward the argument that Imam Hassan alayhi salamullah was actually a friend of Muawiyah na'udhu billah. And injustice in that is to compare someone who is the son of Zahra to someone who is the son of Hind lanatullah alayha. To compare someone who is the son of Rasulullah to someone who is the son of Abu Sufyan lanatullah alayhi. That is a great injustice which has been done to Sayyid al-Shuhada. An example is Amir al-Mu'mineen. He says the first mazloomiyyah which can be done to us Ahlul Bayt, the first injustice which you can do to us Ahlul Bayt, is to compare us to them. It's not befitting. You compare apples with apples. You compare cars to cars. You compare humans to humans. You don't compare the best of Allah's creation to the worst of Allah's creation. You don't compare the angels to the devils. You don't compare the children of nobility and pure household to those who are born of filth. So that is an injustice done to Imam Hassan alayhi salam Allah in that regard. The injustice done to Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam Allah from an academic point of view is twofold. Number one, the Western academia discusses Imam Hassan alayhi salam Allah in the following. That he, salamullah alayhi, was a person who loved to marry and divorce. Na'udhu billah, they make the Imam look like a womanizer. Number one. Number two, that the Imam liked an easy life. He always took the easy route. And number three is that the Imam alayhi salam Allah cared more about making money than he cared about religion. And this Western academia, the thought process, the approach to Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba is very much like their approach to Rasulullah. I'll give you an example with the salawat ala Muhammad. The Western world says that Rasulullah, na'udhu billah, was a womanizer. All he cared about is women, and he married, and na'udhu billah, he's a pedophile, and he marries children, and all he cared about were women. That's one thing they say about the Holy Prophet. The second thing they say about the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him and his progeny, is that he made a lot of peace treaties with the locals in order to further his own political agenda. That he was someone who didn't really care about God, that he didn't really have a message to deliver per se, but rather he was trying to further his own status in society. And when we look at this example, it's very much the same approach that they have used against Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba alayhi salamullah, in that they say he had more than 100 wives, in some narrations they say, right? That he would marry and divorce and marry and divorce and marry and divorce, and that's all he cared about. And that he accepted 8 million dinars from Muawiyah lanatullah alayhi, in return for giving over the Khilafah to Muawiyah. 3 million of those he gave to Imam Hussein, and 5 million he kept to himself. That's obviously a fabrication and a ridiculous claim of the highest order that the Imam alayhi salam Allah would do such a thing. The only narrative that we can find for such an incident is from the narrative of Bani Umayyah themselves. There is no other reliable source. In fact, there is no reliable source, because Bani Umayyah in and of themselves are not considered to be reliable. So inshallah, in the following nights to come, as well as tonight, we will look at the real life of Imam al-Hasan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam Allah, to better understand how we, as people who claim to be lovers of the Ahlul Bayt, as people who claim to be Shia of Ahlul Bayt, as people who wish for the Shafa'ah of Imam al-Hasan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam Allah, how do we respond to such accusations about the first Mawlud in the house of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam? Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam was born on the 15th of the month of Ramadan in the third year Hijri. He was born in Madinat Rasulullah to the daughter of the Prophet, Fatima al-Zahra, Sayyidatu Nisa. And his father is none other than Amir al-Mu'mineen wa Imam al-Muttaqeen wa Yasur. When this child was born in the house of Amir al-Mu'mineen, the people came up to him and they said, Ya Ali, what will you name him? You know, the pride of every person who has a firstborn, the pride here is that, one, there is the joy of the firstborn child. But then also there is this whole process of electing a name for your child. A rose by any other name would still smell as sweet, is what Shakespeare said. But Islam has a different philosophy. Zakariya alayhi salam Allah prayed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. After hearing about the story of Karbala, Zakariya, in Surah Maryam, we are told that he was fearful of the corrupt Mawlanas in his community. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وإني خفت الموالي من ورائي. Oh Allah, I am fearful of the mawali. The mawali is mainly the mullahs of the community, the leaders, religious figures of a community. He says, Oh Allah, I am concerned that these mullahs, after I die, they're going to corrupt this religion of yours. They're going to sell it for a proxy price. They will fabricate the religion. They will make sinning easy. They will make Amr bil Ma'ruf and Nahi al Munkar into Amr bil Munkar wa Nahi al Ma'ruf. Which is what's happening today. Wherever you go into the world, wherever there is a religious group, you will find particular individuals within those religious sects who are trying to deviate the masses from the true message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they do so for their own political agendas, for their financial gains, for their social status, or whatever it may be. So Zakariya alayhi salam Allah prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, Oh Allah, I have never, alaykum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, I have never disobeyed you. And neither have I ever asked you for something and you did not give me. And I've always been content. And I never asked you for a child because I knew you were testing my sabr. And I was content. But now, at the old age that I'm come to, I look around me and I don't see anyone sincere to safeguard this religion after I've gone. So bless me from you, not with a child, فَهَبْلِي مِنْ لَدُنْكَ. So grant me from yourself, not from me, not from my wife, not from my nasal, مِنْ لَدُنْكَ, from yourself, someone who you choose for me, someone who you choose for yourself. فَهَبْلِي مِنْ لَدُنْكَ وَلِيَّ, give me a wali, give me a wasi, give me a khalifa after me who will safeguard this message. يَرِثُنِي, he will inherit me. وَيَرِثُ مِنْ آلِ يَعْقُوبُ, and he will inherit the message of the children of Jacob. وَجْعَلْهُ رَبِّي رَضِيًّا, and make him my Lord, someone who you are راضي with, you are pleased with, you are content with. What is the reason for this dua? فَإِنِّي خِفْتُ الْمَوَالِيَ مِنْ وَرَائِي, I am afraid of the Mawlanas who will come after me, so you give me someone from yourself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds to Zakariya by saying, يَا زَكَرِيَّ إِنَّا نُبَشِّرُكَ بِقُلَامٍ اسْمُهُ يَحْيَى لَمْ نَجْعَلْ لَهُ مِنْ قَبْلُ سَمِيًّا. O Zakariya, we are giving you glad tidings that we will give to you a son. His name will be Yahya. We have never given this name to any creation before him. لَمْ نَجْعَلْ لَهُ مِنْ قَبْلُ سَمِيًّا. Now here's a profound philosophy taking place. Number one, Allah chose the name, not Zakariya. The reason Allah chose the name is because Zakariya said, give me from you someone who you will be ravi with, that he will safeguard this religion. وَجْعَلْهُ رَبِّ رَضِيًّا, and someone who you will be pleased with. And he will be your successor, not my successor, because it's your religion, not my religion. Allah says, I am giving you someone. And I am choosing the name for him. So therefore, a name, or rather a rose by any other name, doesn't smell so sweet. Because here, it's not just the name, it's who chose the name. Custom in our tradition, when the first child is born, we normally give the right of naming that child to the grandparents. It is a sign of respect to our parents to say that this child was only possible because you gave birth to us. So this is the continuation of your good deeds. So you choose a name for this child, right? And the parents will normally choose the name. But here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Yahya is a continuation of my khilafah on earth. So therefore, I elected the name for him. When the people came to Amir al-Mu'mineen, they said, Ya Ali, what name have you chosen for your first Mawlud? He said, the honor is not for me. The honor is for his grandfather, Rasulullah. Because he is the continuation of his lineage. So when Rasulullah came, the people said, Ya Rasulullah, Ali said the naming of the child is for you, because you are the grandfather. Rasulullah said, the honor is not for me. The honor is for Allah. I may be the grandfather, but he is the wasi of Allah. So therefore he is from Allah, and Allah should elect the name for him. So Jibreel alayhi salam Allah descends and he says, Ya Rasulullah, Allah chose the name Hassan for him, a name which he has not given to anyone before him. Sallu ala Muhammadin wa Al-Hassan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam Allah, the very fact that his name was chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes us understand that this is not an individual that we must take lightly. We shouldn't just gloss over his life. We shouldn't just pass, as we say in Arabic, mirarul kiram. We mention and we move on. No, it requires a lot of our attention. This is a very delicate topic in the choosing of the name of Imam al-Hassan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam Allah. Whenever we want to bless something, we say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. When we want to start a deed or a journey or a mission, we have to give it a name to bless that journey and that mission. So we invoke the name of Allah on our deeds. When we enter a place, when we leave home, when we enter a business contract, we say, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. We take the name of Allah so that Allah can bless this deed of ours. But what about when Allah gives His name to something? Not we say Bismillah, but Allah says, I am taking my special name and I am giving it to this particular project so that this project will always be blessed because this is from me and for me. That's why when Jibreel descended on Adam alayhi salam Allah, and Adam alayhi salam Allah, Allah says in the Quran al-Kareem, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, fatalaqa min rabbihi kalimat. He received some words from his Lord, fataba alayhi, so Allah forgave him. I'm paraphrasing the ayah of the Quran. But in essence, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and Adam received some words from his Lord, and with those words, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgave him. When we look at all the riwayat about the words which Adam received alayhi salam from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah forgave him everything, all the narrations say it was the following dua. And in fact, if you read in Mafatih al-Jinan, you will find this dua based from two narrations from Amir al-Mu'mineen and from Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam. Oh Allah, I ask you by the name of Muhammad, and you are the Mahmood. And I ask you by the name of Ali, and you are A'la. And I ask you by the name of Hassan, and I ask you by the name of Fatima, and you are Fatir. And I ask you by the name of Hassan, and you are Al-Muhsin. And I ask you by the name of Hussein, wa anta qadimul Muhammad. These names of Ahlul Bayt weren't just given like that. Allah chose from His special names and He took a derivative and He gave it to the Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam Allah, in that these names will be a manifestation of the Qudra al-Ilahiyya. So the naming of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam Allah lets us further know that whatever it is that Imam Hassan done in his lifetime was always fi sabilillah. Whether Imam Hassan married 100 women or no is an argument for a different day. But for me, if the Imam married 100 women, it was fi sabilillah. I'll give you an example with the salawat ala Muhammad. Abasa wa tawalla. I had this argument, as you do, with the Saudi-funded scholars. I wouldn't call them scholars, I'd call them Mickey Mouse, but nevertheless. And he was saying that Abasa wa Tawalla is Rasulullah. Rasulullah found. And since Rasulullah found, he committed a sin, na'udhu billah. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wa amma as-sa'ila fala tanhar. Do not turn away from someone who asks you a question. So I said, okay, you use that ayah to say Rasulullah sinned. I'm not going to go into the linguistics and the semantics of the ayah of the Quran, because long story short, it's the only chapter in the Quran where Allah speaks to the Prophet in third person. Everywhere else, Rasulullah has either been mentioned by name or addressed in the first person, never in the third. But let's say Abasa wa Tawalla is talking about Rasulullah. Who teaches us what is halal or haram? Do we teach Rasulullah what's halal or haram, or does Rasulullah teach us what's halal or haram? Rasulullah teaches us what's halal or haram. If you believe Abasa wa Tawalla means Rasulullah found, then Rasulullah's frowning is not haram. Because the ayah of the Quran Kareem says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, قَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةً حَسَنًا فَاتَّبِعُوهُ. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, indeed in the Prophet is the best of examples, so follow him in whatever he does. If Rasulullah found, then I should too also frown. Then it became a sunnah of Rasulullah. So even if Rasulullah found on the premise of this ayah, Rasulullah hasn't committed a sin. Because I don't teach Rasulullah his deen, he teaches me what my deen is. So if Rasulullah found and you want to take that premise, it's not a sin. In fact, now it becomes on you, wajib. Because the Quran says, indeed, not maybe, indeed in the Prophet for you is an example. So follow him. It means it's wajib upon me now to frown on people. So Rasulullah hasn't committed a mistake. Because I don't teach him the religion, he teaches me the religion. So if Imam Hassan alayhi salamullah signed a peace treaty, I should agree. I don't question the Imam. If Imam married 1,000 wives, I should agree with him. It's not for me to teach the Imam the religion. He teaches me my religion. So whichever way you look at it, it's a win-win situation for the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salamullah. However, we say, Hasha lillah that the Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam Allah should ever succumb to basic human desires. He is the son of an individual who says to the dunya, oh dunya, oh the glittering of white silver and the shining of yellow gold, have you come to entice Ali? Find someone other than me, for I have divorced you 3 times, there is no returning back to you. Ahlul Bayt never wanted the dunya. Amir al-Mu'mineen has a beautiful poem whereby he says, my nafs knows that me and my nafs are not good friends. My nafs says do something, I say no. Because I only want the rida of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And my only dream is that I have a house in Jannah where my neighbor is Rasulullah. I don't want anything in this dunya. So we say it's far from Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam Allah that they should ever succumb to such a thing. There is a narration about Salman al-Farisi, Salman al-Muhammadi, as we know him, where Muawiyah la'natullah alayhi wanted to cause some confusion. And one of his tactics was, is he asked the Shia following question. If one day you came, and let's say hypothetical situation, you know, it's one of those examples, can God make a stone so heavy that he can't carry it? You know, philosophy. He said, if you came to the masjid and you found, let's just say, hypothetically speaking, you found Ali ibn Abi Talib, na'udhu billah, drinking alcohol, what would you do? Would you stop following him? Would you remove the bay'ah from him? Would you question him? What would you do? Would you reprimand him? Would you advise him? And obviously, fickle minds is the order of the day. So the people began to argue amongst themselves. Some Shia were saying, it doesn't matter if Imam does this. Another group was saying, no, but Imam wouldn't do this. And they didn't know how to respond. Salman came and he said, why are you arguing? What's the argument about? We're in the masjid of Allah, we shouldn't be arguing. They said, Salman, This guy is asking us a question. What would we do if we found Ali ibn Abi Talib, alayhi salam Allah, hasha lillah, that he was drinking alcohol? What would we do? What would you do? He said, it's not rocket science. I'd get a cup and I'd drink with him. They said, what do you mean you drink with him? He said, I don't teach my imam the religion. He teaches me the religion. I am not the hujjah of Allah. He is the hujjah of Allah. If Ali should ever do something, it's because he has hujjah from Allah to do it. I don't question my imam. Allah did not say to me, question the imam. Allah said, follow the imam. And I have absolute yaqeen that this imam would never do something such as this. But if there ever was a condition that something should occur, I would follow the imam. I don't question him. In the same way that people cannot question Rasulullah. Obviously, we find certain companions who question Rasulullah in every nook and cranny of the Muslim history. But lakum deenakum waliya deen. So the idea here is that we should understand whatever the Imam alayhi salam Allah did, it is not our job to question, it is our job to rationalize and find the reason why the Imam did or did not do such a thing. Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam Allah signed a peace treaty. Yes. The question begs itself, why? You see, we can't tell the Imam your signing of the peace treaty is wrong. No. We should question ourselves in order to understand the logic as to why the Imam alayhi salam Allah signed this peace treaty. And when we look in the history of Islam, we can find that had it not been for this peace treaty of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam Allah, you can rest assured that every Muslim today would be ISIS. That we would not be able to tell the difference between Hussein in Karbala and Yazid in Sham. That we would not be able to tell what is haq and what is batil. I'll give you an example with the salawat ala Muhammad. People are led to believe that Rasulullah, when he came, he was able to unite everyone. And everybody was a believer. Everyone. The guy who was yesterday drinking alcohol is now the Khalifa of the Mu'mini. Because obviously being next to Rasulullah makes you a mu'min. Being in the proximity of Rasulullah makes you a mu'min. Apparently so. Well, Abu Lahab was the uncle of Rasulullah and he's in Jahannam. Shaytan was in Sajda in Jannah and he's in Jahannam. The lady who ordered the killing of Hamza used to live shoulder to shoulder with the Kaaba. It didn't change her. In fact, the Kaaba itself was full of idols for the majority of the history. Nothing changed. So being in proximity around Rasulullah does not make you a mu'min. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran Kareem, a surah which was revealed in Medina, which means at least 10 years after the Risala was sent. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. And this is one of the last ayats which was revealed. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. And amongst the people of Medina are the most staunch of hypocrites. You do not know them, but we know them very well. Okay. The word hypocrite already lets us know that these people are pretending to be Muslimin. Pretending to be Muslimin. It didn't say amongst the people of Medina are kuffar. It said munafiqeen. What is a munafiq? A munafiq is one who proclaims something but does something else. So they say we believe in Allah and the Prophet, but in reality they do something else. So this ayah alone lets us know that not everybody was a good person around Rasulullah. As a matter of fact, if they were all good people, Why is it that there was only 5 people in the janazah of Rasulullah? Where did all these good people go? 70,000 Muslims, where did they go? Saqif, of course. So these people didn't come to Islam because they believed. They came to Islam because it was good for business. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Wa idh qalu al-a'rabu amanna bal qulu aslamtum. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran al-Kareem, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. When a group of the Arabs, the Bedouins, came to Rasulullah and said, we have iman. Allah said, nay. Yes, you said you're shahada, you're a Muslim, but you do not believe. You've given the lip service, you've done Islam, but you don't believe. And you will never be considered mu'mineen until iman enters your hearts. What is iman? Iman is nothing but wilayat Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. In the battle of Khandaq, Rasulullah said, when Amir al-Mu'mineen went to face Amr ibn Abdud, Rasulullah said, Baraz al-Imanu kulla. Kulli iman is Ali ibn Abi Talib. And you will not be considered mu'mineen until kulli iman is in your heart. Until you have mawadda for Ahlul Bayt, you're not a mu'min. You are simply a Muslim. So people, and when I say people, I mean Muslims and non-Muslims alike, are led to believe that everyone in the time of Rasulullah, somehow, some way, became pious. And everybody was granted Jannah, and everybody was good, and this and that, to the end of it. And Rasulullah passes away, and within hours, before his holy body was even cold, people could not differentiate between Ahlul Bayt and the corrupt individuals. And they marginalized Ali Rasul and they put others as Khalifas. And an individual as noble and respectable as Malik ibn Nuwayra is killed along with his entire tribe, and his wife is raped by someone called Khalid ibn Walid, who today they call him the Sword of God. He rapes the wife of one of the most notable companions of Rasulullah. They all go in Jannah. It's not a problem. People were not able to differentiate. And the problem is that this hypocrisy was born, or rather it showed its face, at a time when Islam is expanding after Rasulullah passed away. Which means what? Which means someone like Muawiyah, who was already residing in Medina for more than 30, in Sham for a good 30 years, and enjoyed unsupervised control of the entire Sham and the majority of Egypt, and was telling the people that he is from Ahlul Bayt, and he was giving his own twisted version of Islam to people who have never seen Rasulullah. Neither have they seen Amir al-Mu'mineen, neither have they seen Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba, nor have they seen Imam al-Hussein, nor have they seen Fatima al-Zahra. So these people now, whatever Bani Umayyah are giving them as Islam, they see it as the real Islam. They began to believe that Bani Umayyah is the true Islam. The only counter-narrative that existed at the time was the school of Ahlul Bayt. And the school of Ahlul Bayt moved from Medina to Kufa. And in Kufa, the school of Ahlul Bayt was betrayed in the battle of Nahrawain, where the Khawarij left the army of Imam Ali, left him and turned against him. So the Ahlul Bayt were betrayed from every angle, and there was no sense of loyalty to them. And everybody saw Islam as a get-rich-quick scheme. And they saw it as an opportunity to go from a nobody into being an empire. And nobody was able to differentiate between the son of Zahra and the son of Hind. No one was able to differentiate between the son of Rasulullah and the son of Abu Sufyan. Muawiyah, with his unlimited resources and finances, and with his media was able to manipulate the minds and the hearts of the people. The ones who could be bought, he bought them out. And the ones who he didn't care to buy, he tricked them and lied to them through his media. His media came in the form of Abu Huraira. His media came in the form of Umar bin As. His media came in the form of fake narratives about Ahlul Bayt. As a matter of fact, even in the books of the Ahlul Sunnah, there is the following narration that Muawiyah said, fabricate traditions about Ahlul Bayt. And whatever Rasulullah said good of them, say it about us. And he made it incumbent that Ali ibn Abi Talib's name be cursed on the minbar for 8 years. It continued even after his death. So now, the people don't know who's who. They see Muawiyah, la'natullah alayh, as the peacemaker. They see Muawiyah as the good Muslim. And they see Imam Hassan alayhi salam Allah as the troublemaker. So when we fast forward to the Battle of Madain, where Imam Hassan, more than three of his generals were bought out. They go to war. Muawiyah gives them 30,000 gold coins. They come to Muawiyah's side. And when the leader of the army walks away, the normal foot soldier is going to think, well, why am I fighting for? Why don't I also go to Muawiyah's side and get some money for myself? Muawiyah comes and he puts Madain under siege. And he is a very cunning person. He knows that in Medina, he cannot win the people if he kills Imam Hassan. As a matter of fact, he said in his will to Yazid la'natullah alayh, do not kill Imam Hussein. Never go to war with Imam Hussein, for he holds a special place in the hearts of the believers. And if you kill him, everything that we have worked for will be taken away from us. Muawiyah was clever. He lived amongst the Romans in Sham. He learned the art of poisoning. He learned policy. He learned how to do sabotage personalities, character assassination. He understood all of this. Whereas Yazid la'natullah alayh, Yazid was spoiled. He grew up in a world of anything I want, I must get. He wasn't used to people saying no to him. So when Imam Hussein refused to give him the bay'ah, he couldn't hold himself, neither did he have the tactical espionage of his father. He didn't have the appetite for politics. So he went forward and he killed Imam Hussein, and that ended everything. But had it not been for Imam Hassan alayhi salam Allah, the death of Imam Hussein would have gone unnoticed. And I'll explain to you why with the salawat ala Muhammad. Yazid la'natullah alayh, or Muawiyah la'natullah alayh, presented himself as the peace-loving individual, as the Khalifa of Allah, as the kind person, as the true standard for Islam. So the people didn't know any wiser. And the ones who knew didn't care because they're being paid to stay quiet. So when he comes to Madain and he puts it under siege, he doesn't want to force Imam Hassan into a war that inevitably Imam Hassan will be killed in, or his army will be annihilated. As in the army of Muawiyah la'natullah alayh. So he plays a very, very clever game. When his army comes to Madain, he makes an announcement. He says, oh people, I don't want to go to war with your Imam. I don't want to kill you. I'm a Muslim. I believe in peace. But Imam Hassan's a troublemaker. So I'm going to make him an offer of peace. And if he is truly a man of peace, he will accept my offering. Imam Hassan alayhi salam Allah knew very well that this peace treaty is not going to bring any fruit in the shape or form of reforming the Muslim nation. So therefore, he had to make the peace treaty work to the advantage of Allah's will, not the will of Imam Hassan. And therefore he put conditions in the peace treaty that will expose Muawiyah as the hypocrite that he was. Imam Hassan alayhi salam Allah stipulated in the peace treaty the following. Because Imam is now caught in a catch 22, if you would. If he refuses the peace treaty, history will forever remember him as a warmonger. And if he accepts the peace treaty based on the conditions that Muawiyah sets, then they would consider him defeated. So the Imam says, I don't want war. You don't want war? Fine. I will prove that I don't want war by agreeing to this peace treaty. But you also have to concede to my points, to my terms of negotiation. What were the terms of negotiation of the Imam? Number one, you do not turn Khilafah into an empire. Your son Yazid must not inherit you. If you die and I am alive, Khilafah comes back to us. And if I am no longer alive, it goes to my brother Imam Hussein alayhi salam. You return all the zakat and khums owed to the Shia of Ali ibn Abi Talib, whom you have denied them all this time. You immediately cease the cursing of Ali ibn Abi Talib on the minbars. And you immediately, as of the signing of the treaty, you stop harassing the Shia of Ahlul Bayt, the people of Iraq, whom you have kept them under complete oppression. Stop oppressing them. If these objectives are met, I'm happy to agree. Muawiyah lanatullah alayhi says, I agree. He signs the treaty. Everybody gives bay'ah to Muawiyah. Muawiyah, as soon as the bay'ah is finished, he stands up. He says, now that I am your Khalifa, they say, yes, you are the Khalifa. He rips up the peace treaty of Imam Hassan and he puts it and he steps on it. And he says, this is the peace treaty between me and your Imam. It is beneath my feet. Now that I have complete authority over you, I will let you know the following. O people of Iraq, I did not wage war against you so that you may pray, nor is it that you may fast, or that you may go to Hajj, for these are things that you know better than me already. I only came to rule over you because I like to have authority over you and I want to subdue you. At this moment, everyone was like, Imam Hassan was right. Muawiyah is actually a bad person. In the signing of this peace treaty, Imam Hassan alayhi salam Allah brought about the real agenda of Bani Umayyah. And that is what you find, that as soon as Muawiyah is dead, more than 100,000 letters are sent to Imam Hussein alayhi salam Allah, asking for a change because they no longer desired the oppression of Bani Umayyah. Abasa wa tawalla. If the Prophet frowned, I don't question, because Allah said, I obey the Prophet. When Imam Hassan signs a peace treaty, I don't question the sanity of the Imam. I don't question the integrity of the Imam. I don't question the policies of the Imam. I find the reason behind what the Imam alayhi salam Allah did. For surely, there is always a reason. The Imam, in doing so, laid the foundation, and that is why he is known as Al-Muhandis, the architect of Karbala. Karbala people would have believed that Imam Hussein was an oppressor, na'udhu billah, in the same manner that the people betrayed Imam Hassan alayhi salam Allah, had it not been for the peace treaty of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba. Had Imam Hassan alayhi salam Allah not exposed Bani Umayyah for their fallacy and their corruption, today our religion would be the religion of Yazid. Today the only narrative we have of Islam is the narrative of Bani Umayyah, the narrative of ISIS. And we are only one hair away from that reality. 80% of the Muslim world still subscribes to the religion of Bani Umayyah. 80% of the Muslim world still subscribes to the religion of Bani Umayyah. They may not know it, but they do. They still think that Ahlul Bayt are second, which means they subscribe to the religion of Bani Umayyah. They mention the name of the victim and the killer in the same key and say they were friends, the religion of Bani Umayyah. They say that the Prophet is not Masum, the religion of Bani Umayyah. They say that the Prophet used to sin, the religion of Bani Umayyah. We, that fine line of 20% of the Muslimin, owe our entire narrative to Sibt al-Awwal, Imam Hasan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam. Allah, so honor him with the salat. The second issue is that people come forward and say Imam Hasan al-Mujtaba should have gone to war with Muawiyah. Imam should have not sat down. Na'udhu billah, some people even come forward and say Imam Hussein was braver than Imam Hassan because Imam Hussein went and didn't care about death. Whereas Imam Hassan, no, he gave up. He gave in. Again, these are the people who haven't really read Islamic history very well. But the idea is this. Imam Hassan did go to war against Bani Umayyah. But Imam Hassan was betrayed in such a way that his own janamaz, his musalla, was stolen from beneath his feet while he was standing in namaz. By his own people. It's not that the Imam didn't want to go. Imam went. But let's say the Imam didn't go. Are we in a position to criticize the Imam? No. What did Rasulullah say? Al-Hasan wal-Husayn Imaman Qama aw qada. Hasan and Hussein are your Imams, whether they stand and fight or whether they sit and do nothing. Obedience to them is wajib upon you. Is there any verification of this in the Quran Kareem? Of course there is. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Surah An-Nur, Ayat al-Nur. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Allahu Nur al-Samawati wal-Ard. Allah is the light of the heavens and the earth. What does it mean by light? If I switch off now, the lights will be off, it will be dark, there's no Nur. Do we mean by Nur of Basar or Nur of Basira? Basira. Meaning what? Allah is the guidance of the heavens and the earth. Allah is the one who guides the stars and the sun and the moon and everything else. Allahu Nur al-Samawati wal-Ard. As an example, he says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. He is the one who sent amongst the non-believers a prophet. يُخْرِجُهُمْ مِنَ الظُّلَمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ. He takes them out of darkness to light. Was Mecca in an eclipse that Rasulullah took them out of darkness? No. Darkness here is jahiliyyah. Nur is hidayah. Okay. Allahu Nur al-Samawati wal-Ard. Allah is the hidayah, is the guide of the heavens and the earth. Mathal nurihi, not mathalihi, mathal nurihi. The example of his guidance, not the example of Allah. Why? Laysa kamithlihi shay. There is no example of Allah. But there is an example to understand the nur of Allah. There is an example to understand the hidayah of Allah. What is the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How does Allah describe it? It is like a lantern within a niche, surrounded by a clear glass. So clear, it shines bright like a celestial star. It receives its light from the oil of an olive tree that is blessed neither from the east nor from the west. So, from Jannah. Shajaratun mubaraka. La sharqiyya wa la gharbiyya. The oil that is produced by this tree, the olive tree, is so pure in essence that even if you did not bring an ignition to it, it will still produce light. There is no need for combustion. Which means what? Which means the light of this tree, the light of Allah's hidayah, is unconditional. We do not put the conditions of science and rationale and so on and so forth onto this tree, because it's la sharqiyya wa la qarbiyya. It's neither from the east nor from the west. It comes from a different universe, which means it's measured to a different standard. So therefore, our lack of understanding of that universe means whether we see it working in our understanding or whether we don't see it working in our understanding, it's still working. It does not need ignition. It's not conditional. Al-Hasani wal-Husayn are imams, whether they stand or whether they sit. There is no need for their condition. In the same way, this olive tree produces light without combustion, without ignition, without the need of source of fire. It is the source of hidayah. Imam Hassan and Hussein do not need you and I or any other group of believers or non-believers to teach them their responsibilities. They teach us our responsibilities. So whether Imam Hassan alayhi salam Allah did rise, or whether Imam Hassan alayhi salam Allah chose to sit in seclusion, it's not for me and you to discuss, because what we have to take from him is obedience. We must give obedience to the Imam. Someone can turn around and say, that's blind following. It's not blind following. But if you want to call it blind following, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين الذين يؤمنون بالغيب. The majority of our religion is based on unseen. Jannah is unseen. Jahannam is unseen. Allah is unseen. The angels are unseen. The devil himself is unseen. The grave is unseen. Barzakh is unseen. Mi'ad is unseen. The reward of my salah is unseen. I don't see it. I pray, but where does it go? I don't know. So I'm ready to accept all of this. But when it comes to the authority of Ahlul Bayt, now I'm a bit wishy-washy. But then I see someone who's fasiq, and I say, yeah, he's Khalifatullah fil ard. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran al-Kareem, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, is an individual who is walking, falling flat on his face in need of guidance, equal to the one who helps him up and shows him the way? Say, how can you compare the one who is in need of guidance to the one who guides? Surely you are in a manifest error in how you judge. Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam Allah did not sit at home, but even if he did, we do not question him, because he is the Imam, not us. The Imam tried and tried and tried, but unfortunately the people were so confused, either willingly or out of ignorance or out of desire for the dunya, that they did not care about the Imam alayhi salam. To the extent that his janamaz is stolen, his ring stolen, his turban stolen off him while he prays, stabbed in the thigh with a poisoned dagger by his own companions. His own wife administrates the poison to him. How many enemies was the Imam surrounded by is the question we're asking here. How mazloom is this Imam? And then we have someone who has the audacity to come and say that in all his life, all the Imam cared about was women. That all the Imam cared about was wives, wives, wives. To that end, historically speaking, there is only an account of the Imam having three wives. Three, no more. One was the princess of Persia, who chose the Imam for herself as a husband. The second was a wife which the Imam chose for himself. And the third was a wife which the Imam had to marry for political reasons. Ju'da, la'natullahi alayha. And this Ju'da, like many of the other people around the Imam, was bought by the promise of power. Where Muawiyah, la'natullahi alayhi, said to her, if you administrate the poison to Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba, after your waiting period is over, I will marry you to my son Yazid. And Yazid, when he becomes the Khalifa, you become the queen of all the believers. You become the queen of the most powerful empire in the time. Blinded by this greed, she comes to Imam Al-Hasan Al-Mujtaba alayhi salam. Let us dim out the lights as we recollect the final moments in the life of this mazloom Imam. An Imam who was so attached to Fatima al-Zahra alayhi salam. An Imam who was the joy of the heart of Zahra. Whenever Rasulullah and Amir al-Mu'mineen used to go out, we've all seen children. When dad goes to work, the sisters will understand this more than anybody else. When the dad goes to work, the son will always pretend that he's the father. He will sit where the father sits. He will read the father's newspapers. Jokingly, he will put on his glasses. Because children aspire to be like their parents. In this narration, Imam Hassan alayhi salam Allah, whenever Amir al-Mu'mineen and Rasulullah used to go out of the house, Imam Hassan, when he was only 4 years old, would sit in the house and put on the turban of Ali ibn Abi Talib. And he would begin to repeat whatever his father said in the previous majlis. And Fatima Zahra would look on and she would smile. And whenever Imam Ali alayhi salam Allah comes home, she says, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, I wish one day you would be here to see how Imam Hassan loves to follow in your footsteps. To see this young child of yours, how he likes to pretend to be you. So Imam Ali alayhi salam Allah said, O Fatima, tomorrow I will pretend to leave the house. And I'm going to hide in the other room. And I want to listen to Imam Hassan as he pretends to be me. So Amir al-Mu'mineen is hiding in the other room. And Imam Hassan is sitting in the room. And Fatima Zahra is looking at him. And she says, oh my son, tell me how your father speaks in the majalis. And Imam Hassan blushes. And his cheeks turn red like roses. Shabih al-Mustafa. Fatima alayhi salam asks him again, oh my son, speak. And he stays quiet. And a third time she says, son, speak. He says, mother, how can I speak when I can feel the nur of Ali ibn Abi Talib in the other room? I cannot speak in his presence. Such a lovely child, such an obedient child, such beautiful akhlaq, such morals, morals which he inherited from Rasulullah. Yet I ask you, Amir al-Mu'mineen and Fatima Zahra, how would you have felt on a night like this? Where Imam Hassan is sitting with the turban of Amir al-Mu'mineen. But he is unable to speak, not because Ali is there. He is unable to speak from the pain of the poison. Jorda gives him a drink of milk and honey mixed with poison. And Imam Hassan alayhi salamullah takes a sip. And she sits there and she says to the Imam, drink some more. And the Imam says to her, I have drank enough to satisfy your desire and the desire of your master. Be away from me before your sins are exposed. Jorda flees. Imam Hussein alayhi salam was out running some errands. When Imam Hussein alayhi salamullah returned, ajrukum ala Allah, he walks in and he sees Imam Hassan. In front of Imam Hassan there is a plate. In the hand of Imam Hassan there is a stick. And Imam Hassan is moving a piece of meat in the plate, left and right, left and right. Imam Hussein alayhi salamullah looked at the piece of meat and he fell to the ground and he said, La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. It was the liver of Imam Hassan alayhi salamullah, which he had coughed out into that plate. Imam Hassan looks at Imam Hussein. He sees Imam Hussein weeping. He says, Aba Abdullah, do not weep too loudly, because I am afraid that Zainab might hear you. And if Zainab hears you, then she will come here and she will see what has happened to her brother Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba. But before Imam could even finish his sentence, there was Zainab alayha salam at the door, looking at Shabih al-Mustafa. What can she do in such a state? She cried out, Ya Fatima, Ya Ali, Ya Rasulallah, here is Hassan al-Mujtaba, ajrukum ala Allah, but I wish... I wish that that would have been the final of the masa'ib that befell Ahlul Bayt, mu'mineen and mu'minat. They took the janazah of Imam Hassan alayhi salam Allah to Medina. They wanted to bury him next to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. But that mal'una, that wife of the Prophet, was standing there and she said, no, by Allah, they will not bury him next to Rasulullah. So she shot the first arrow, ajrukum ala Allah. More than 72 arrows were planted into the mayyit of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba. Can you imagine that a janaza is returned for a second ghusl and a second kafan? Imam Hussein alayhi salamullah with his own hands and Zainab and Abbas having to remove 72 spears from the body of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba. Then they took him back and they buried him in Jannatul Baqi' next to the mother of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Walakin ajrukum ala Allah. What were the final words of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba? When his head was in the lap of Imam Hussein, what did he say? La yawmuka yawmuka ya Aba Abdullah. No day is like your day, O Aba Abdullah. What did he mean by that? What was he referring to? Yes, Imam Hassan alayhi salamullah had 72 arrows in his body, but at least there were people to remove the arrows from the body of Hassan al-Mujtaba. Ajrukum ala Allah. Karbala, Imam Hussein alayhi salam, laying on the plains of Karbala by the river Euphrates, thirsty. The narrations say there were so many arrows in the chest of Imam Hussein that the chest of Hussein looked like the back of a hedgehog. Was there anyone to remove those spears and arrows? No, by Allah. Mu'mineen, do you want to know how those arrows were removed? Those arrows were removed when the horses were kicking the body of Hussein left and right until they crushed the chest of Aba Abdullah.
لا يومك يومك يا أبا عبد الله إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم على لعنة الله على القوم الظالمين وسيعلم الذين ظلموا آل محمد أي منقلب سينقلبون مات من حسين يا حسين
يا حسين
يا حسين
يا حسين, يا حسين.